Welcome, everybody, to the Men Engage Global Symposium and this important session on masculinity and climate change, good practice examples of men as allies of women. I'm delighted to be moderating today. My name's Nikki van der Gaag, or van der Gaag. I'm an independent gender consultant who's worked on men and masculinities for about 15 years. And I'm a senior fellow at Promundo and also on the steering committee of Men Engage Europe. Give you a bit of context here. This is a series of seven seminars as part of the Ubuntu Symposium on climate crisis, men and climate justice. And I'm sure some of you will have listened to some of the earlier ones already, but they're also available to listen to later on. And as I said, today's on masculinities and climate change, good practice examples of men as allies of women in fighting climate change. And there are some key questions for the whole series that have been developed. You can probably read these, but I'll read them out anyway. How can we as members of the Men Engage Alliance be accountable to youth, mainly girls and women who are in the front lines of climate justice? How can we, with our feminist knowledge and experience in how to engage boys and men, contribute to the transformation from domination to care? What can our movements gain from joining hands? And how can we together inspire, develop, and renew a common political agenda and strategy based on care to meet the urgency of today's existing and emerging challenges? Put those the wrong way around. Okay, so just a little introduction, and then I'm going to introduce our really exciting range of speakers. So we know that masculinities can drive global warming, but we also know that many men have been helping in the struggle to save our planet. And while patriarchal values are harmful to the planet, many men are using their knowledge and power as allies of women. And for me, this webinar continues a discussion which began when I wrote a State of the World's Girls Report for Plan International in 2013 on girls and young women and climate change. And I realized at that time that most of the research, and there wasn't very much of it, in this area was on women rather than girls, and it was not very nuanced either. So women were either victims of climate change or they were heroes in the kind of struggle against climate change. And men and boys weren't mentioned at all. So in 2017, I was really pleased to be invited to collaborate with Men Engage on a paper on men, masculinities and climate change, which you can find on the Men Engage website. And I noticed that Men Engage has also just produced a document for the Gender Equality Forum called Feminist Action on Climate Justice. And it's got recommendations for action, which you can find on their website. It notes that by working together, men, women, and persons of all genders can challenge the patriarchal systems that perpetuate climate change and leave behind a more gender just and ecologically sustainable society for future generations. In the past few years, I've been working a lot on care, including on the state of the world's fathers, and particularly thinking about it during the pandemic. It seems to me clearer than ever that we need a complete reframing of care so that we value it and we broaden our understanding of what it means, not just for ourselves and our families and our societies, but also for our planet. I love the words of Nancy Fulbray, who you may have heard of. She's director of Program on Gender and Care Work at the University of Massachusetts. And she says, our most important assets, natural assets, ecological services, and other people do not have a market price. They are not bought and sold. So valuing care doesn't necessarily mean valuing it in monetary terms, but valuing it as something as absolutely key to all our lives. And I know that our amazing speakers from Sweden, Russia, Belgium, and Brazil are going to give us new insights into this vital subject. So I'm going to start by introducing our first three speakers. What we're going to do is have three speakers and then they will have a short conversation with each other. I know everybody's been staring at screens for a year now, so it's nice to have something slightly less formal. And then we'll have two more speakers and they will have a conversation. And then we will answer some of your questions. If you want to put them in the chat box, please do. Keep them brief. We will try and get to as many of them as we can by the end of this session, which lasts for 2 hours. So our first three speakers, Nathan Grossman is a Swedish documentary filmmaker whose work often explores environmental issues. A graduate of the Stockholm Academy of Dramatic Arts, Grossman began his career as a photographer for Rolling Stone India before shifting his focus to film. He gained global attention for his 2015 short film, The Toaster Challenge. And in 2017, he completed his first full-length TV series about the growing meat consumption in Sweden. His latest documentary, I Am Greta, about climate activist Greta Thunberg, premiered at this year's Venice Film Festival and has won multiple awards. And I hope you, if you haven't seen it, I would really encourage you to do so. Announe de Wever van der Heijden is a Belgian climate and human rights activist, organizer of the Belgian School Strike for Climate by Youth for Climate and Fridays for Future, author of Wij zijn het klimaat, an intern with campaigns and outreach team with the Greens in the European Parliament. Together with her movement, she's led campaigns on EU policies and worked together with scientists on climate action plans and attended high-level meetings to address the urgency of the climate crisis. Last year, she sailed to the Amazon forest to build coalitions between the defenders of the Amazon and EU movements, which led to a mutual campaign by different actors in civil society to boycott the Mercosur trade agreement. And finally, in this section, we have Marcelo Salazar from Brazil, who's a Brazilian industrial engineer who's been working with traditional Amazon communities for over 20 years to support their sustainable development and protect their rights. He's executive coordinator of Health in Harmony in Brazil, which endeavors to strengthen indigenous and river communities in the Amazon rainforest. And he's also an advisor for Forest Economy, an NGO focused on integrated solutions to social and environmental problems, and a member of the Council of Instituto Socioambiental. So we have three fantastic speakers. I'm going to ask them to speak for about 10 minutes each, and we'll kick off with Nathan, if that's okay. Nathan, over to you.
Thank you for such a nice presentation and such a nice thing to be speaking about this when I generally speak so much about filmmaking and so on. But as Nikki said, I'm a director. I work mainly with documentary films, and actually the last 10 years, mainly the films I've been doing has related to, and somewhat to climate change or environmental topics. And I don't really know why it became like that. It's probably just because I'm so curious of topics that tend to be very big and touch upon global issues. And when it comes to climate change and environmental destruction, that's the topic that my generation of filmmakers, that probably the biggest topic that we have to tackle and tell the world about. But I think for me, one of the most interesting things making films about this subject matter has definitely being a man, started with a series I actually did probably 6 or 7 years ago for the Swedish Public Broadcasting Union, which was, it's the equivalent of the BBC in Sweden. And I had understood that there were so many masculine ideas that related to things that were bad for the environment. And one of them was meat consumption, which was on the topic back then. I think this was in 2016 or 2017, which, when it was really big in Sweden. And we made this series about a comedian who was an old guy, born maybe like in the 1950s or 60s, that loved to, you know, eat lots of meat and hunt. He was like a hunter. And it was very interesting. So we kind of challenged him as this kind of grown-up masculine guy to stop eating meat and to really look deep into his kind of views when it came to environmentalism and climate change and also meat consumption to a large extent. And it was really my first contact with how with the gender kind of imbalance when it came to this specific subject matter. Because many of the experts that we spoke to and many of the cases that we found were mainly women and mainly young women. And I think at that moment, I didn't think much more about that. We did the series, it became super controversial and very funny. But if, a little bit later, I stumbled onto another person to make a documentary about. And then I really started thinking more about this. I think we can play a small trailer of the film that I did last year.
People always tell us that young people are going to save the world. But there is simply not enough time to wait.
the fallout from climate change.
The impacts could be catastrophic.
All of this with the global warming, it's a hoax.
It is the most pressing issue of our time.
You have to go to school.
When it came to the climate crisis, I saw my parents were just like everyone else. We weren't doing enough. For many years, people refused to listen to me. Children were very mean. But I don't care about being popular. I care about climate justice.
She felt she had to do something, and she had to do it on her own.
Is climate change an issue that children like herself should be concerned about?
You suffer of Asperger syndrome.
I wouldn't say suffer from, but I have it. When I get interested in a subject, I become laser focused.
There's a real movement that's growing.
Greta comes up on stage, she speaks, and her words are devastating.
My name is Greta Thunberg, and I want you to panic. We are in the midst of a mass extinction.
Time is running out.
I can't just sit there and watch her do all this for the environment and do nothing.
We will be a pain in the ass. We will keep on striking until they do something.
We don't want to burn out.
I think you should especially be really careful.
I have been invited to the United Nations Summit. And since I don't fly, it's going to be a challenge.
This is all wrong. I should be back in school, on the other side of the ocean.
What we are doing now, future generations can't change. Despite all the beautiful words and promises, our political leaders have failed us.
Some people are so arrogant to think they can change climate.
She faces a really, really tough journey.
Nothing is happening, so we must do what we can. We will not stop until we are done.
You read a lot on climate?
A lot. I'm a nerd.
Oh, that was a small glimpse of the documentary I Am Greta that was that I started filming. Actually, the first day when Greta Thunberg started to strike, I was able to start filming with her. And I must say that part of what I was interested in was that she was a very young woman and that she felt very representative for a worry that many young people had. And coming from doing a series about this older man, I thought that this would be very much of a kind of more of a generational issue than a gender issue. But actually, I must say that I was very surprised because following the early climate strike movement in Sweden, there were practically only women and younger women that were part of this movement. And I was surprised by how few boys that were on these strikes early on. And I remember I even filmed a scene in the beginning of the climate strike movement when some of these young teenage strikers sat. And then there was this this class that passed by. I think it was like a high school class. And the women in that class, they sat down on the cobblestone together with the climate strikers. And the guys, they just, you know, stood and they walked over to a bench on the other side of the street. And it just was this very weird image of how imbalanced this worry for climate change tended to be. And I was surprised by that. But what actually happened and what was so amazing was that as the movement started to grow, because this was, you know, in the beginning when the strikes were super small, we're talking 40, 50 people in Sweden. But as the movement started to grow and as Greta started to travel and I traveled with her filming, we started to visit countries like Holland and Belgium, where Anuna, for instance, have been doing a great job with these climate strikes. And I started to see more and more and more boys on the streets starting to join these strikes. And when I was in New York, which was the end of this film, and it was in September and at the kind of the peak of these strikes, when it was huge, we're talking millions of school strikers, I was stunned by seeing so many men and so many, especially younger guys, walking in this march. And I think what my takeaway was from that was that it seemed like in this topic, when it came to the climate strikes, at least, it was like the girls were the early adopters, in a sense, that they kind of saw this issue first, and that the men tended to be very kind of reluctant into going into these strikes. But as the strikes kind of grew and as it became more mainstream, at least in the parts of the world where I had the were fortunate enough to capture it, it seemed like more and more men felt that stepping into that world was easier. So I think my biggest takeaway and my kind of hope for the future of this fight for the climate is that hopefully more and more men will feel that it's easier now to kind of step into working with climate change than it was before, as this is not a kind of movement on the fringe anymore. This is not something which is not mainstream. And I think some men maybe have been a little bit reluctant into going into it because they don't know. Yeah, they feel that this is like a subculture or something. But my gut feeling is, and my hope is, that more and more men actually will start taking part in the work for climate change. And myself, I hope that it won't become a gender issue in the future, because I think it more deserves to be, if something, a generational issue. So young guys like me and even younger boys will be very affected by climate change as well, even though we've seen in many studies that women actually globally will be more heavily affected. But younger men will be very hardly affected. And I really hope that they will understand that and that they will rise against many of the ideas of that men shouldn't be a part of the climate movement or so on. So that's my hope for the future.
Thank you, Nathan, very much, and really interesting to hear from you as a maker of that film. So, Anuna, I think you're next. I think we saw you featuring it very much in the I Am Greta film, and really looking forward to hearing about your work. Shall I bring up your presentation now?
Yes, please, Nikki. That would be great. And thank you very much for letting me speak on this event. And thank you very much, Nathan, as well, for your story, because it is beautiful. And I always like listening to your story. So thank you very much. I'll start maybe by introducing myself. I want to give in this session the perspective of Youth for Climate and Fridays for Future International on the masculinity and climate change. And I want to give you reflections on our perspective from that side, because as Nathan said, also we in the climate movement have noticed a big tendency of the fact that there is more girls and women, especially leading the movements, initiating the strikes, initiating these coalitions. And this is something we saw happening as well. I thought about it a lot as well. And so I want to give you our perspective. You can go to the next slide, Nikki, if that's okay. So I am Anuna de Wever. I'm a Belgian human rights and climate activist. And I was actually raised by two activists. So I've always been aware of the inequality of this world, the inequality of the system that we live in. I've been aware of climate change, and I've also been very aware of my privilege and the fact that it buries a lot of responsibility as well. Although I'm a female, I am white, I am middle class, I come from Europe, I have a lot of responsibility because of my privilege. And my parents taught me this from a very young age. I used to go to refugee camps with my mom and see how different people with different backgrounds and different cultures are being treated very unequally in this system. I also knew about climate change and I knew about the climate crisis, but I remember thinking when I was younger, if this is actually such a huge problem as we always hear about, then our politicians would really do something. I couldn't believe that nothing was happening. But as I started to read and talk more about it, I realized that nothing was happening. I realized that our politicians aren't taking this crisis seriously. I realized that our policies are way behind on the targets that science tells us to go to. And so I wanted to do something. And someday my mom comes in when I'm eating breakfast and she shows me a little piece in the newspaper in Belgium of a Swedish climate activist, Greta Thunberg, striking in Sweden. And it was a very small thing back then. It wasn't global news. She was there every Friday with a lot of Swedish people. And I wanted to help out. But obviously I couldn't go to Sweden to sit next to her But what I could do is initiate our own Belgian climate strike. And that's what I did. You can go to the next slide, Nikki. I made a call out for people to join me on this strike. And 2 weeks later, 3,000 young people were in the streets of Brussels marching for ambitious policies when it comes to climate change. It was a very big strike. It was all over the media. It was a huge thing in Belgium right away. And you can go to the next slide. All of a sudden, there were millions of people around the world striking. In Belgium, it went from 3,000 to 15,000 to 40,000. And then all around the world, in every country, movements were building up. I think at some point at a global strike, we counted 8 million people around the world. So this is just a counting. But in every country, there were so many people striking. It became a global movement. And as we've said before, and you can go to the next slide, women and girls were initially leading this movement. It was very feminine. You could see that there was a lot of female leadership. And also within all these local countries, within these coalitions that we're building, within these WhatsApp chat groups and Telegram chat groups, it were mostly girls that were leading these coalitions. But soon enough, you can go to the next slide, we also saw a lot of boys coming. And indeed, this was not in a leadership role. This was way more in a supportive kind of role. These boys came in the movements to help us, to be allies, to use their privilege as well, being white, often being male, to help us and support these movements and go to the right places. Also within the climate movements, we need to step away from gender roles. It doesn't matter who you are, where you come from, what gender you identify with, or what skin color you have. This is a mutual fight, and we're all fighting for one common cause. And I think that's a beautiful thing that my generation is also showing by having so much diversity in these strikes, because it shouldn't even be a generational fight. It's just a fight for humanity. So everyone, wherever you come from, whoever you are, we kind of need you. And so that is also something that made me very happy to see that finally boys and men were joining our strikes. You can go to the next slide. One of the first things that happened was that President Emmanuel Macron invited us to go and speak with him. And this was actually pretty unprecedented because he was one of the first world leaders that really took us seriously and really wanted to listen to us. I am not saying at all that he is doing sufficient political action to fight the climate crisis. This is not the case. But he did make an unprecedented symbolic action by meeting us, by taking us seriously. And afterwards, in a conference in Romania, even rallying more than 9 heads of states to also see us. So he took the lead there with the world leaders. He showed that we had to be taken seriously, that we came with a very big urgent matter on the table that needed to be addressed. And I'm very happy that he did that. You can go to the next slide. There were also in Belgium mostly, because that's where I held the strikes, there were authors, there were public figures, scientists, experts that joined. These were typically white men in privileged and powerful positions, but they were supporting the movement. And we need to have different kinds of people with different kinds of backgrounds and power to push from all the different sides of society. And that is also why diversity within the climate movement is so important. Plus on that, for example, an Austrian study actually shows that if there is more women in decision-making, there's also more climate ambition. So also this is in the interest of men to support women to take leadership roles, especially when it comes to politics and climate change, because we just see scientifically that there will also be more ambition. You can go to the next slide. On a later stage, we also initiated a climate action plan, and this was specifically for Belgian policy, because we wanted to give our politicians a concrete scientific tool to adjust their policies on. And also here, men in power joined us. These are typically great white old men, and they weren't taking over the project, they weren't taking over the panel, but they were helping us coordinating all these scientists to work together on a mutual climate action plan. You can go to the next slide. So baseline, when we talk about inclusivity in the climate movement, but just in general, it always reminds me of my experience in the Amazon forest. And there I met all different kinds of activists, scientists, indigenous leaders, and we brainstormed together on an action plan to save the Amazon. We had a conversation with Chief Raoni, which is one of the most important indigenous leaders of the communities in the Amazon forest. And he told us that it was important that we, together with millions of people around the world, carry out his legacy and fight for the Amazon. It being a world heritage and the lungs of the earth, it doesn't matter at all where you come from or where you are. It's a common fight altogether. And this, for me, kind of sums up what the climate crisis means to me. And you can go to the next slide. We need everyone in this fight. The climate movement needs everyone. It's not about gender. It's not about race. It's not about sexual orientation or culture or heritage. We just need everyone to fight for us. And there is a reality that some people have more resources and tools and privilege than others. But we need different people from different corners in society to work together and fight for the same cause, because this is, after all, about humanity. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Anuna. That was really inspiring. And I think that whole message around it's a common fight is so important. So you talked a bit about the Amazon. We're going to now move to the Amazon and have Marcelo tell us a little bit about what he's been doing, which I know is linked. I know you met, didn't you, when you were there. So it's a nice link. Marcelo, over to you.
Well, thank you very much for this invitation. I'm here in the banks of Xingu River in the middle of the Amazon rainforest in Altamira. And it's a very, very important topic, like cross gender and climate crisis. It's so important. And I would like to start with, I remember when I received the invitation of the first time I came to Altamira 15 years ago. And I was the first guy from the Social and Environmental Institute here. And I was allocated in a small office of the women movement here in Altamira with two Antonias, Antonia Melo and Antonia Martins, very powerful women from the Transamazonica movement. And I learned how strong that elder women were in this region, because they came to the Amazon rainforest after the Transamazonica road was opened, destroying the forest by the militaries at the time. And while the men were working in the land, so the women start to put together a movement to fight for health, for education, for their children, and so on. And it became a very strong movement that inspired my generation, that inspired many others. So my first role here in Altamira was support that elders, women, to fight against Belo Monte Dam. And Belo Monte Dam was a huge fight, like Haunee, that Anuna mentioned, was known by the world because of Belo Monte Dam fight. But there was a woman, Tuira Kayapó. I would like just to share, if I can, this image. Can you see? This is in 1989. Tuira Kayapó put a machete in the face of a director of Electro Norte in that time. And this image went all around the world. And Tuira was not so famous as Raunee, because she didn't, she was a woman inside the village. But in this meeting, she was so strong, and this image went around the world. But Raunee was the guy that becomes famous because of the Belo Monte fight. And this is, it's tough, in my point of view. The indigenous communities, they have the man as a the stronger image as our society as well. But what I think, this is changing a lot. And I fight a lot with the Antonias here in the Amazon rainforest. And they realized it at that time that for the grassroots movement to be sustainable, they should conserve the forest to have rain and this kind of thing. So they started to fight not only for education and health, but also for the environment, to have rain and to have water. And that is was when the social movement from the road met the movement from the indigenous territories. And jumping many, many years until 2019, from when I met Anuna and Kathleen and this movement of Friday for Futures, like it was in my life a very strong moment and changed it the way I see the world right now. Like it brought me like the emergence, like we need to change it now. Like we have for the Amazon rainforest 10 years to change everything. And I think we have 10 years to change all the world. And it's not only the environment and the fight between the forest and the development, but the fight between be together in the world, fighting together, giving space to other people to fight, giving space to other voices. I think I was very happy in that time in the Amazon rainforest to be the one in the backstage, like supporting the experience of a group, mainly a women group, coming from Europe, meeting some other women and men coming from the middle of the forest and be together, talking, learning from each other, listening. So I think listening is something that is very important. And many times we don't listen enough, like listen and act. So this is something that is very, very powerful. So like, I went from the elder women from the social movement in the Transamazonica to support the young women from the movement of Friday for Futures and also the movements here in Altamira. And after this meeting, there is a young movement organizing themselves. So now I have, I'm connected and trying to support as much as I can this movement of women, mostly, but men as well. Like Daniela from Xingu Vivo, Juma, Shipaya, it's an indigenous leader in this region as well. So I think it's very important for us to change this energy. Like we are in a fight of models of world development. On one side, a lot of old white men trying to convince us that the development means open roads, build huge power hydroelectric plants, and so on, and destroy the forest. And in the other side, like the indigenous people, together with social movements all around the world and the new generations telling that there is another world that is possible, that we cannot depend on this old model of development. So I think the energy is young and the energy is it's the male. So even in the men, we need to get and to connect ourselves to the female energy. So I think this is our challenge. And I want to finish showing like a 1 minute video just to remember that moment in 2019.
Povos indígenas, comunidades tradicionais, quilombolas, agricultores familiares, estudantes, cientistas, pesquisadores da Amazônia e do mundo se preocuparem em discutir o que está acontecendo no nosso país.
O mundo tem o dever de defender a Amazônia.
Porque não é que tem floresta onde chove. Chove onde tem floresta.
E quando a gente pede o futuro da Amazônia, pelo futuro da Amazônia,
A gente pede pelo futuro de todas as pessoas.
Sim, resistimos! Estamos aqui mostrando a nossa voz!
So that's it, like in short words, a little bit of the experience. And thank you very much for this invitation. We can discuss a little bit more.
Gente, caímos, mas voltamos, estamos de volta. Não deu para todo mundo assistir o finalzinho do Poco.
Obrigada, thank you very much, Marcelo. That was fantastic and lovely to see that film. The power of that came across really, really strongly. So we'd like to have a little conversation now between the three of you. I also have a couple of questions, but I'm going to let you go first. So Anuna, do you have a question for either Nathan or Marcelo?
Yeah, well, thank you, Marcelo, for your presentation. It was absolutely beautiful. And I remember the strike in the Amazon and I absolutely miss it. Nathan, I also want to thank you for your film, because when we are talking about inclusivity of the climate movement, I think it is also films like you that make boys and men less reluctant to actually join these movements because they realize it's a common cause and it has nothing to do with gender. But I was wondering how you feel about being a white privileged man in this society, whether it also gives you a bigger responsibility of fighting the climate crisis because of the abundance of privilege, basically.
Yeah, definitely. I really feel that responsibility. And I think I had a teacher when I studied at film school who told me, you know, Nathan, documentary filmmakers in Sweden, or at least in Europe, they tend to earn the least per hour because they put so many hours in. So are you really do you really want to do this? And I felt like, yeah, because I am privileged enough to actually take that risk in my life. And I understand that there are lots of people that don't have that those possibilities, you know. And I think then the kind of falls on not just my shoulders, but some people that are privileged, our shoulders, to tell these stories and also to help other people who don't have those kind of financial resources to also tell their stories. I hope that in a few years, or maybe in 10 or 20 years, the teacher of my film school won't teach people like me, actually, and that she will never have to tell her students that you guys probably have to have financial gains from your family or whatever to make these kinds of films. So yeah, I feel a responsibility now, but I hope I won't feel it in maybe 20 years.
Thank you. A good question and a good answer. Can I follow up by asking all of you, really? I was just conscious of what Marcelo was saying about getting men to listen. And I wondered if any of the three of you, Anuna, you were talking about boys already being involved, but I wondered what strategies you'd have, particularly for getting men in power, like you old white men, I think you called them, to listen. Because, you know, a lot of the decisions those men are making are driving climate change. So Fridays for Future is clearly getting those men to listen. We saw the photos in your slideshow, but I wonder if any of the three of you have ideas for strategies to get them to listen, because seeing the I Am Greta film, there were clearly a lot of old white men there who were not only not wanting to listen to what Greta and Fridays for Future were having to say, but were actively saying really horrible things about her. So I'm really conscious, Anuna, and you and your colleagues, I really think what you're doing is fantastic, but I really recognize that that's not easy. So how can we get these men to listen?
Yeah, I could answer first on that. What we do mostly is when we are in these meetings with old white privileged men, which basically happens quite a lot, we try to make them very aware of what their privilege means and of the fact that also the climate crisis, the consequences of it, it affects people unequally as well. It's not those men that will bear the hardest and most acute and urgent consequences of the climate crisis. Mm-hmm. So we try to also tell them the policies that you are writing now, the law that you're implementing, the decisions that you are making will not only affect you and the climate crisis will affect you least. So this is a huge mm-hmm. responsibility you are feeling, you should feel, because you're in this position of power. And so you need to think about all the intersections of this world. It is not people like you that you are writing these policies for right now. And so trying to make them aware of it, but definitely having a climate movement that is more diverse and that is more intersectional and more representing of all these different kinds of people definitely helps by telling that story. And that's also why we are really trying to move a lot of the spotlight and the mic to the global south, because that's mostly where climate crisis is hitting right now. And those people are not as privileged as us, and they don't get those platforms. And so having those people talk to those world leaders, those white old men, really helps. Having indigenous communities talk to people like Bolsonaro, that is what we need to make happen, because those are the people that are being really affected by these policies.
Thank you. I think, Marcelo, I was going to ask you that question. I suspect it's very difficult to say what would make Bolsonaro listen if even the generals can't make him listen. But do you have an answer to how you get someone like Bolsonaro to listen, or at least someone, the people around him to listen, perhaps?
I feel that Bolsonaro don't have ears to listen from this generation. They have no ears to listen from indigenous leaders. He is a genocide. We are here now in Brazil with more than 3,000 deaths a day because of COVID-19. The deforestation in the Amazon rainforest increased incredible in the past 2 years. And this guy makes fun about the indigenous people way of life, makes fun about deforestation, makes fun about COVID-19. So I think we need to fight to get this toxic man from the power. Like, I think there is no more space for men like Bolsonaro and Trump in nowadays in our society. So all we are doing is to work against this kind of model and replace completely this energy. It's been very tough in the Amazon rainforest to be listened, especially for the indigenous people these days. In this sense, the privilege that Anuna said, the privilege of Nathan and you guys, it's very important, because now more than ever, we depend on international community support. We depend on international community pressure to our government and to our society. So I hear from markets like they are curious about the new generation. Who is the new generation? Who they will buy? They are afraid of you, Anuna, afraid of you guys and the huge movement you are creating on the streets. So you have double power in your hands, because people are looking at you and say, oh, we need to design something to this generation. So demand right, demand strong, as you guys are doing to move the development model to another direction.
Thank you. Such important words and such an important point. And people are dying. People are dying because of the decisions that these old white men are making. Nathan, did you have any questions you'd like to ask your fellow panelists particularly?
Yeah, I was interested because, and I think this maybe starts as a question for you, Anuna, and then maybe you could fill in, Marcelo. But I was interested because me and Anuna, we haven't had the time to speak about this. It's, you know, so much water is running under the bridge and everything is happening. And I felt that and that's not kind of empirical in any way, but I felt that in the beginning of the climate strikes, there were almost no men. And as you said, in the end, there were might not that many men on leading positions, but at least on the streets, I could see much more young guys. And I just wondered if you have any idea why, because it seemed like in your presentation, you also spoke about that. Do you have any idea why that happened? When did the guys start to march with you, and why did that happen? And then following on to Marcelo, I'm wondering if he has seen any trend in Brazil with men being more and more kind of engaged in this issue.
Yes, I've honestly noticed that as well. And that's why I thought it was so interesting that you mentioned it too, because I also saw a gradual change. What I noticed in Belgium is that when the climate strikes became cool, because we were civil disobedient and we were rebelling and politicians were like, ah, the new generation, then guys started joining us. So for some reason, just protesting without it being a very cool show made guys very reluctant of joining. And I don't know why that is. I do think it has up to a certain extent to do with toxic masculinity and the fact that boys are raised to not feel sensitive. And for example, you could say that the climate crisis has to do with connecting with nature and reconnecting with the system. It also has to do with rebelling and critical thinking and redesigning a system. But I think there are some aspects in there that are harder for guys to express in this society than for females. And that is, I think, partly a reason why it happened so gradually and why it definitely started with girls. But as I said before, by telling that story, that this is about humanity and this is about an entire system that we need to change together, and it has nothing to do with gender whatsoever, I do think it touched upon a lot of boys, especially men, and also the whole rebelling and civil disobedient thing of it all definitely made guys come on board, and I'm super happy that they did.
Marcelo, do you want to come in at all there in terms of the context of the Amazon? I know your internet's coming and going.
Yes, but I can hear you. So I would like to know more from Anuna and Nathan. What are the next steps for you guys in this COVID crisis, that we can't go to the streets as before? And how are you thinking this change, and we need to shift quick in many aspects, in gender and climate crisis and so on? And what is the plan? And how can I support this plan for you guys, youth, and especially females?
Well, something that we realized during the COVID crisis, after having a lot of meetings on reflecting on the past 2 years, is that one of the biggest issues is still that people are unaware of the urgency of the matter, and that people are unaware of the consequences it has on human beings, on human rights, on the fact that millions of people are dying and will die if we don't act. And this sense of urgency will only come if people are aware of the issue. So what we've been doing during COVID is really raising awareness, doing online campaigns, also doing a lot of meetings with high level important people behind the scenes to try and manipulate policies. As you know, we've also worked on trade agreements between Europe and the Global South, for example, Mercosur trade agreement, for us being white privileged European activists trying to help activists in Brazil, in the Mercosur countries, in Latin America, to build these coalitions between movements. And that is also something that we are currently doing with Youth for Climate, but also Fridays for Future International. Work more with MAPA people, so most affected people and areas, people on the front lines of climate change, people that are right now experiencing the hard consequences of climate change, because at the end of the day, they should be the ones telling the story. It shouldn't be us. We are talking about our future. There are people right now that are experiencing it today, and they should have the stage, they should have the mic and the spotlight to be able to talk about this. And so these are things that we're trying to do, build these coalitions, pass the mic, and we will continue doing that, because for me, that is the essence to really change the system.
Thank you. We have only a few more minutes before we move on to our next speakers, but we have a question that's directly with the three of you, really. Marlene Mondaka says, I work for an organization called Save the Children, an NGO, which I'm sure everybody knows. I'd like to know what role you feel organizations like Save should be playing to support this movement. Maybe that's the last question before we move on. I'm sure there'll be more in the chat later on, but would any of the three of you like to? I think you've already started talking about that, Marcelo, in terms of a new concept of what we mean by development, and that involves international NGOs as well as leaders of governments in terms of reconceptualizing. And Anuna, you already talked about driving this from the Global South because they are going to be more affected. Is there anything else, Marcelo or the others, you'd like to add to answer that question?
I'm not an activist, so I can definitely not speak about how you can help activists. But what I can say is that I think that that helping tell the story about how extremely affected younger people and younger generations will be because of climate change. I think that's something that Save the Children, focusing on children's rights and children's future, can make a big difference in, because this is really something that we need parents and everyone practically, which is old enough to have money and influence in the world, to know. So that's a really important thing from a storytelling perspective.
Thank you. So Marcelo, Anuna, any other comments on that or any final comment things you want to say?
So I think we are in a moment, in a tough but very special moment, that we must to imagine the future. We are most likely bound to the present or the past, and now we need to move our bodies to other places, to uncomfortable positions sometimes, and we need to innovate innovative solutions that begins with good and powerful dreams, like awake or not. Like, we need to be radical dreamers right now and radical listeners, especially to the indigenous people, that because they feel like very well the teeniest variations on climate, and especially the women, they are connected to the forest, and they can realize what is changing, and they are the first to tell us, oh, be careful with this and that. But not only because of in the forest, but they know how to live in a society connecting the forest, the people. And so we have a lot to learn and to listen from them. I think this is what I would like to say. Like, let's change our positions, let's experiment other things and be radical dreamers and act fast. Like, we need to move fast.
I love that, radical dreamers and radical listeners. And certainly colleagues in and friends in Black Lives Matter movement have been talking about how, you know, white people and privileged people need to be uncomfortable too. And that really resonates in terms of what you're saying. Okay, I think we could carry on for a long time, but I think we need to, that was my doorbell. I think we need to move on to the next speaker. So thank you very much. I'm sure there'll be more questions. I can see them coming in already. But, fantastic discussion, wonderful presentations. Thank you, and courage to you all. So we now continue this really amazing conversation. I'm learning such a lot with two more speakers from Russia and from Sweden. So Marina Pislikova-Parker and Vida Vetevelk, both of whom have been involved with Men Engage for a very long time. Marina is the leading researcher at the Gender Studies Division of the Institute of Socioeconomic Studies of Population at the Russian Academy of Sciences. She's an author, researcher, and activist on violence against women. She's been the recipient of numerous awards, and she's one of the founding members of the Global Council of Vital Voices Global Partnership, and also a member of the Advisory Board for Women Against Violence Europe. She's involved in a call for a global treaty on violence against women and girls, where she's a member of the steering committee of Every Woman Treaty. I'm looking forward to hearing from you, Marina. And Vida Vetevelk is a certified psychologist who's been active in the feminist organization MAN in Sweden since its inception in 1993, working to engage men and boys for gender equality and ending men's violence. For Vida, as for MAN, holding men accountable through close cooperation with women's movements is central to the holistic work on violence prevention. Vida grew up on a biodynamic farm. I've only learned that today, Vida. It's really interesting. And he's passionate about the interlinkages between gender equality, the environment, the climate crisis, and how to engage more men to care. So I'm really looking forward to hearing from both of you. But we're going to kick off with Marina. Marina, would you like me to put up your slideshow? Just tell me when.
Okay, yes, please. Thank you very much. It's really great to be here today, very inspiring panel. And I'm going to speak today as a researcher and also how the research is combining and inspiring activism and action from NGO community and different professionals. Please let me, can we have another slide? I want to start on a review of gender equality in Russia. As different Rankin says Russia goes actually backwards on gender equality. According to Global Gender Gap Index, in 2020, Russia fell from 75th to 81st place. According to World Bank, from was ranked one at the 122nd place out of 190 countries. And at the same time, women are 54% of the Russian population. And at the same time, women have less jobs, basically. Only 55% of women are included in the economy, while 70% of men are employed. And one of the problems in the labor market for women is, of course, gender pay gap. Women earn 28% less than men for the same skill level. Next slide, please. I represent the Institute for Socioeconomic Studies of Population here of the Russian Academy of Sciences. In April 2020, we had a survey on the COVID pandemic consequences. And it actually revealed that the household work performed by women under lockdown went up in average 1.5 times. But actually, if we take into the account that at the same time, half of female respondents worked remotely and 20% of them were involved, had to go to job to their workplace as usual, we can say that load of household work for women during the lockdown increased many times. Next slide, please. In 2016-2018, we started doing survey in the Republic of Karelia, trying to see what are everyday practices of environmental behavior of population in that region. The object of the study was the region of Republic of Karelia, and the subject of research was gender characteristics of the daily practices of the ecological behavior. Next slide, please. And the uniqueness of this methodology, which actually I want to thank Martin Hultman for helping us to develop. It was evolving from one year to another. Is that the focus of the survey, at least for Russia, it was not on environmental issues in general, but specifically on how people in their daily life practice and how aware they are about environmental issues and their influence, each of them. And we had the following assumptions. First, that formation of individual environmental awareness depends on gender socialization, gender asymmetry influences not only distribution of domestic labor, but also the formation of norms of ecological behavior every day. Process of environmental modernization should include a gender component in order to form effective programs aimed at combating climate change. Next slide, please. Some results that are actually we expected to them. But it was good to get statistical data for Russia. It was interesting that two-thirds of respondents agree that every day, that every person can contribute to improving the state of environment. So actually, there is awareness there. On the other hand, Russia is still a very deeply patriarchal country. Women continue to do most of household work, and most of respondents confirmed it. At the same time, 50% of men and 50% of women are satisfied with the way they have assigned responsibilities among themselves. And it's interesting because that was in the quantitative in answers to the questionnaire. When we had in-depth interviews, women showed less satisfaction and were much more direct with the fact that men should participate in household work. Household waste is separated only by 7% of men and 8% of women. The main reason is still lack of containers and logistics for that. Water filters are not used by almost 70% of men and women. And only 30% of men and 28% of women buy organic products. Most of the population buy products that are cheaper. Basically, what we found, and again, it's not the secret, but we were able to confirm that environmental habits are very much defined in Russia by income level. Next slide, please. Some other results. Patriarchal traditions widespread. 32% of men believe that a man should be head of a family. He should manage and control a woman, otherwise the family will not survive. However, more than 60% of men and 90% of women say that men should be interested in a woman's needs, understand her, take care of her, and reach mutual understanding. At the end, the opinion that a woman should obey, listen to a man, and serve him, otherwise the family will not survive. Only 16% of men and 4% of women agreed to that. Next, please. I just gave you a flavor of the research. There were interesting connections that we were trying to find out, connecting violence against women and violence against nature in that survey. And basically, women were much more supportive in, for example, supporting statements that those who will not be violent against nature will not most likely not be violent in intimate relationship. Last year, actually, in March, a year ago, ESSP held a workshop on environment and masculinities, and Martin and Vidar spoke there. And that actually inspired several activities. One of them, the school, Green Driver School, ESSP researchers went through the training on environmental with environmental activists and also some women's organizations also went through that training. The purpose of that is to design a new program on gender and environment because our movements were separated before that. Now we are trying to put our activities and bring research together with activism and NGO activism and in environmental and area and in the area of violence against women. The research actually was used and is used by organizations that develop programs on fatherhood and ecological behavior. There was an exhibition called Green Father. And today, one of the participants in this seminar is Maxim Rusanov. This is a picture actually from his group. After the workshop, he started a program for men, men between detachment and aggression, the experience of discussing attitudes with empathy towards themselves, towards women and nature. And that's Astrakhan Crisis Center. This is a very innovative program. It's a beginning, but these are some pilot programs that happen in Russia. Of course, environmental behavior in Russia is well known for being mostly women. And one of goals for these programs is also to engage more men in participating in environmental movements. Next slide, please. And as Nikki said, announcing me, I participate in a global call for a need for a global treaty on elimination of violence against women and girls. It's called Every Woman Treaty. You can go to this website and read about that. Basically, why I'm bringing up this here is also because in conversations with different nations, while we are trying to find lead nations for drafting a treaty, and I've been involved in that for the past 7 years, voluntarily and as a member of the steering committee, we started using actually this connection of aggression against women and nature, having the same trends in, say, having the same roots in patriarchy, and you know, the same approach of consumption without responsibility. I think we live at the time when it is actually becoming more and more evident that we do need to change some very basic rules, and these are gender equality and equity rules. But at the same time, there are some very strong, urgent situations with climate crisis and with violence against women that exist on Earth as a result of the existing norms. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Marina. You covered a lot in a very short time, and I'm really interested in the idea that men who are not violent against nature are not violent in intimate relationships. So we can come back to that. Okay, so we move on to Vida. Vida, you're going to share your own screen?
Yeah.
Okay, over to you straight away.
Thank you very much. I'll start by getting the screen up. Can you see this now?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, thank you very much. I will tell a little bit about very concrete work that we've tried to do try to engage more men for gender equality and for the environment and the climate, basically for climate justice. And we've talked a lot about the root causes patriarchal structure and the masculinity norms as some of the important root causes behind the crisis that we are in the middle of, both environmentally and climate-wise and socially. And I like to show these three images. I've showed them many times before, maybe some of you have seen them before. And these comes from the research of Martin Hultman and Paul Poulet, who are also on this call with us today, where they talk about three types of masculinities, where one is the industrial breadwinner masculinities, and The one other one is the eco-modern, and then the third one is the ecological masculinities. And I like to also talk about them as egological and ecological, because it's a whole set of logics. And if the first gray one is the really, there we find the men who are climate change deniers, who see the nature, the women, the people as something to use to gain their own profit. It's denying that there are any problems whatsoever in this. There's a lot to say about this, and the images are very simplified and also very strange with the different animals and different orders and all of that. We don't need to go into details around that. But the second one is the eco-modern, which is also ecological order. It's still a patriarchal order based on principles like deviation to divide and to also oppress and have superiority and dividing in over and under, and the ones who are over can use the ones who are under. Here we can find ourselves and the people and politicians and decision makers who do realize that we do have challenges. We do need to handle the climate crisis and the environmental crisis. We need to do something about it, but the solutions that we come up with are maybe more wind power, electrical cars, many times technical solutions only, and it doesn't challenge the structural dimension. It's not changing the structure and the system and the logic. It's the same logic, but just a little bit more green. And then we have the ecological order, which is here is gender equality. Here is the awareness that we are an ecosystem. We're not just a part of an ecosystem. We are an ecosystem with everything interdependent on each other. And for me, this image is more illustrating, and this logic is more illustrating the real reality, whereas the two others are human constructions. And we use so much energy and resources to keep those human constructions in place. Whereas in the ecological system, more energy can be freed out for cooperation, for real needs, and for reciprocity and abundance. The two other systems are built on scarcity, telling everyone you have to consume more in order to be happy. Pornography is a terrible example of that, where you men and young boys learn what sex is about and from the pornography, and it becomes more and more violent to get aroused, to get kicked, because it doesn't give what your real need is, which is intimacy, closeness, and that you never get there. And then you want to buy more, and you want more and more kicks. Whereas in the ecological order, or in the gender equal, and where you meet, actually to meet another person and the intimacy and to meet your real needs of love and connection is all for free. 30 seconds of really looking deeply into someone's eyes is revolutionary, and it's for free. And the same in the connection with the nature. When we stop seeing it as an object somewhere out there that we can just use for consumption, and we connect, there is richness there. We can meet and find our real needs. So I really love when Marcelo speak about radical listening and radical dreaming, and I think we really need to start to talk about this eco logic. What that is. It's not about moving back to Stone Age, and it's about moving forward to something that is much, much richer than what we have today. Yes, that as a background. So how can we move from ego to eco, from patriarchy to partnership? And how can we engage more men in that transition? Because men are, as we've already heard, missing. And we have been thinking about how can we bring in men as part of the solution, basically. And one thing that we have done is to develop, this is a small drop in the ocean, of course, but it's something practical that we're trying. And we've developed it together with Chalmers University in Sweden, with Martin Hultman and Paul Pelé, and together with the garden, coming back to that biodynamic farming that I grew up in. This is a permaculture and biodynamic garden, which also works with growing vegetables, but also with growing humans. So in collaboration, we've developed a reflective, a reflective guide for groups of men, which is really, really about practicing listening. So I was so happy to hear you all talk about the importance of listening. Men really need to practice that and to learn and to listen both to myself and to others. And it's totally revolutionary to just sit in a room that is safe and brave enough to start to listen. What do I really need? What am I really longing for? And how are masculinity norms and patriarchal structures, how have they influenced me and blocked me from all of that? How have that contributed to me being violent towards others? How has it affected my relationships? And to start to listen to each other as men it's revolutionary in itself, because it's so, so needed. And this is only a beginning of practice in order to be ready to listen to women. So there is listening, sharing, reflecting, and action. And in the end of the material, we're really looking at, we need to do something. And who do we need to do it for? Not just for us, but who do we need to do it for? And who are already doing all the work for gender equality and for climate and for environment and for climate justice? Well, yeah, it's the girls and the women. So we need to listen to them, and we need to ask them, how can we support? How can we be allies? How can we help? What can we do? So that's kind of the process in those 8 sessions in the material. And I would like now to maybe just show these books as well. The left one is The Ecological Masculinity, is written by Martin Hultman and Paul Pelé. That's the kind of scientific base for the work. And then we're also basing it, the practical exercises, very much on Joanna Macy's work, Coming Back to Life, and the work that reconnects, and Active Hope. And what we have added to her work and her exercises is the masculinity lens, the gender and power analysis, which is not so strong in there. But we put that in. Robin Hedenqvist did research and deep interviews with participants in these groups of men. And one of the conclusions from what the men had with them from the groups, from participating in the groups, is that to feel part of something simply makes it harder to dominate and easier to care. It's all about connecting, which is, of course, part of the stereotypes around masculinity, is to be disconnected from yourself, from your emotions, from the women, from the world, and just use it and consume it. But to connect makes it harder to dominate and easier to care. Robin is also with us in this call today. And now I want to, this is an invitation. We have finally decided to Sorry, something is happening here with my computer. To invite you all and everyone you know who can be interested to participate in an online, international online group to do this material, to be together and pilot test it together. And it will be in May, starting 5th of May, every Wednesday from 3 o'clock till 5 o'clock p.m. CET time, Central European time. And we will have the last session the 2nd of June, which is the last day, is the day before our last session in this seminar series as well. So we will bring the experiences from our pilot testing together to our last session in this seminar series as well. We'll soon send out invitations with links and all of that. We didn't manage to get that all in place before today, but please save the dates and share this save the dates with whomever you think might be interested. We will do this. We will design it in a way where we can be. There's no limit to number of participants because we can do things in the big room all together, and then we'll go into small breakout rooms and do the sharing in small groups. Yes. And if you're interested to join this, please write your email address in the chat now and we'll get back with more information. That's what I wanted to say now. Yeah. Thank you.
Ida, do you want to put your email in the chat as well in case people don't actually get to write their email at the moment, but they want to follow up with you later on? I think that might be a useful backup.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you both very much for really interesting conversations. I know that you know each other really well, so you've probably asked each other all the questions you already want to ask each other. But I want to give you both the opportunity to reflect on what each other has said and see if there's anything you'd like to ask before we move to opening to the participants. So Marina or Vida, have you got a question to ask of the other person?
Vida, do you have questions? So I go first.
Go first, please.
Yeah, I find it really fascinating, this work. And I think it is, although you either said it's a drop in the ocean, I do think that's how the change starts. And it's inevitable that it starts with each of us. Can you please tell me, like, your main insight, main insight in transformation of men in their awareness towards women and nature as a result of your first groups that you've had?
Yeah. Thank you. I will try. I touched upon it already. Yeah, I was very touched myself by realizing I'm not alone. Realizing there are other men who also do really care for wanting to be caring and not be tough and all the masculinity stereotypes tell us to be, to care and be close with yourself, with friends, with a partner, with children. And I had been working with that a lot before, with gender equality and masculinities. And then to also bring in the dimensions that we do care for the environment, for nature, for everything that is not human as well. I thought, in some strange sense, I thought I was alone. I felt very alone in that. And I realized, actually, for the first time that I could feel truly safe in a group of men. I've been in a lot of groups of men and have male friends and all, everything. But here we were sharing our pains and our longings. And I realized I'm not alone and I feel safe here. And that has helped me in meeting other men after that. I realized how scared I had been until then for all the dynamics going on in relation with other men. And here I felt I could really drop all of that and just be there and listen to them and to myself. And out of that comes all the care in practice. And that's also shown in Robin's research, that other participants share the same, that instead of having ideas of what is right to do and kind of do it because you think it's a sacrifice maybe to stop flying or stop doing this or that, it becomes something I need to do. I cannot continue like I did before. It doesn't feel possible. It's not a mental thing anymore. It's embodied. Yeah, I can share much more, but I think that's some of this.
That's really interesting and really heartfelt. Thank you. That's fantastic.
Thank you.
I like the idea of it being embodied. Do you have a question for Marina?
Yeah, many, many questions.
Just one.
Yeah, I'll try. Okay. So, well, one maybe is, it's a really difficult one, but the same one that you asked in your previously asked, I don't think if it was Anuna or maybe you, Nikki. Yeah, it was you, Nikki. How to get men in power to listen? In your context in Russia, Marina, I know you've chosen, as you shared, you've chosen kind of a way of focusing on individual change and because that is a way to move. Is it possible? What is your thoughts on how to get men in power to listen, also in your context?
Well, we are like complementary to environmental movement that exists in Russia already. So basically, there is actually a lot of environmental organizations that are trying to influence policies and that are already working very hard to change the situation and influence. And I think Russia did make some official steps in that, signing the Paris Agreement, etc. And I know that there are seminars, for example, at Skolkovo on how to get to the greener economy. So there are like some steps at the top, and there is movement at the grassroots. So I think what we are trying to do is engage in more, people, more, men, women, who didn't think about it before, and bring more awareness in a daily life. And that was, in our view, a missing piece. And I don't know how to deal with urgency of the situation. I think actually, I agree, we have globally very much behind. And I think it is important that politicians everywhere realize that. But I think a combination of personal awareness and movements, that, joining forces, including internationally, I think that's the only way we can do it.
I think that's a really, really important point, that you have to work at the grassroots, but you also have to work at the top level. I was really interested, Marina, by your presentation talking about, for example, even something like household waste, And the reason it's 8% and 7% is because there isn't anywhere to put it. So it really illustrates for me that individual change has to be supported by structural change, and individual embodied, I think, Vida, that's really right, embodied understanding also needs to be supported by civil society and by movements. And dare I use the dreaded P word, but the way that patriarchy is affecting all of us is so key here in terms of caring for the environment as well as caring for ourselves. So thank you both so much for really interesting insights into both your different situations. And I can see lots of people already signing up, Vida, so I hope you'll have a good team of people. I'd like to invite our first panelists back on again, if that's okay, if you can unmute yourselves and put your videos back on. Thank you. And if you could, they be spotlighted so we can see them clearly? I don't know whether you can. Oh, great. And so Nathan and Marcelo as well. Could you spotlight Nathan? Bianca? And also Marcelo? Okay. So we have a number of thoughts in the chat box. Paul's talking about the second book on ecological masculinities that Vida mentioned, that's coming out soon, that he's written with Martin Hultman. And also, so the idea of ecological masculinities, and Paul's interested in your collective thoughts around the ideas that Vida was putting together. But I also want to give you an opportunity to comment, because obviously the first three could comment on each other's presentations, and the second two could comment on each other's. But do any of you want to come in on some of the presentations that you might not have had a chance to ask? So if any of you've got questions for the other people on the panel, you're very welcome to bring them in. I'll give you a couple of minutes to think, because I want to ask you a question for everybody. And that we talked a little bit about the pandemic, but this hasn't really been a conversation about the pandemic, but obviously it's hugely affected all our lives. It's why we're all connected here, but it's also why we're not able to see each other. And I'm really interested in what your perspective, you know, in Brazil, it's clearly really terrible, and it's been driven by a president who's made it worse. I think the same's happening with our prime minister in the UK. But do you think there are ways in which the pandemic has provided an impetus for change on climate change? I'm wondering whether you feel that, I know there are many negative things, but are there ways in which you feel the pandemic might help us to get out of the mess that we've got into? I know that's a difficult question. Anuna. Yeah.
I could touch upon that. I've thought about it a lot, especially being an activist, having to sit at home and not being on the streets. It has kept my mind busy. But for me, the COVID crisis was a huge metaphor in comparison to the climate crisis. All of a sudden, there is a lot of money to spend. All of a sudden, science is being taken seriously. All of a sudden, we don't need a huge platform to actually push through radical policies that are necessary to battle the crisis. So for me, the COVID crisis actually showed that politicians can handle the crisis, that politicians can listen to science if we take it seriously enough, if it's acute enough. And the thing is that the climate crisis is worse. It is not as urgent as the COVID crisis was, directly affecting billions of people. But the climate crisis is way bigger, and it will affect way more people than the COVID crisis did. And so this is something politicians also need to be more vocal about. And this is something we saw with Corona. When politicians and when media are actually vocal about what the crisis means, you also can do a lot more, because people understand, people are aware, and people will support you in those measures. So for me, that is something that I hope people will remember after the COVID crisis, what a normal response is seeing a crisis happen.
Thank you. Really, really good point. Anybody else want to come in on that?
I would like to say that for many years, we've been telling people that their health and well-being are affected by the health and well-being of people living in the rainforest communities. Half a word away. But it was only being with the pandemic that most people are finally getting it. We really are all interconnected, and the pandemic bring it to us, men, women, south, north, city, forests. So I think we got this sense in a worst way, but we got.
Thank you. Anybody else?
Yeah, I can only agree with Anuna. It's what I've spent lots of now with my latest film being released during the pandemic. I've been in many seminars speaking about that. And I think you put it very correct, Anuna. And I remember in the beginning when the climate strikes began, lots of the strikers said, treat the crisis as a crisis. And I remember, you know, hearing that, and it didn't relate to me. I was like, okay, what does that mean? You know, let's edit it out of the movie. I don't understand it. And I think now we're in a completely different situation. Now we've defined what is a crisis and what is a reaction to a crisis. And I think, and I really, really hope that younger generations and people who are very concerned about the environment will use those arguments coming forward into 2021, 2022.
Mm-hmm. Marina Vida.
Yeah, I think what also, I mean, became evident and obvious that violence against women went up during the pandemic, as well as our research shows the amount of work that women had to do during the pandemic in those societies where, you know, gender equality is not, I think it is also like majority on earth, frankly, because household work is not seen yet as really a big issue. And in societies with better economic situation, you know, yes, there are more convenient ways to do household work, but they were also environmentally, I think, more damaging. So there are things that come into the picture, and that we definitely need not to forget these lessons, because, you know, this is our way. When the situation goes away, a lot of very valuable lessons actually go away, unfortunately, too. And I think we need to really make sure that we learn from that.
Yeah. Thank you. There's an African feminist called Theo Soa who said, building back better is not good enough. We need to, you know, people talk about building back better, actually, but before wasn't very good. So we really need to think about what better means. And I think that's really important. We have got some questions coming in. Vida, did you want to come in quickly on the pandemic question, or should I move on to the next ones? You're muted. I had to say that one time in a webinar.
Sorry. No, I don't need to add anything. Okay. But I would like to just remind all our participants to write your questions and so on in the chat, and that it's also okay to write something in Russian, because then Marina can read it out.
Yes, sorry, I should have said that too.
It will be interpreted.
Thank you. So we have a couple of really good questions. One from Martin Holtman, who says, Martin, I'm sorry I'm reading it out. It's just too complicated to kind of unmute everybody. But in Sweden, we have a sexual consent law put in place by feminist movements. Can something similar in your minds be put in place by the environmental movement, such as stop ecocide law and rights of nature, changing human relationships with nature within and outside of our bodies? So relationship between law and change. I don't know if anybody has any thoughts on that. It's a really interesting idea. But laws obviously do change things. Anuna, yeah. Did you want to come in?
Yeah, with the Fridays for Future movement, we actually wrote an open letter to all heads of states and world leaders. And there are some of those demands in there, indeed implementing ecocide and reconnecting this idea that these ecosystems there are keeping us alive, and that it is not just a hippie thing to think about that, but that is true and it should be put in a law. If you destroy an Amazon forest, this is a consequence that it has on people, and that is not in any law right now. There's so many things that we are just taking for granted, although they are completely insane. And so with Fridays for Future, we really try to question all these things, put them down, treat them as demands. We also raise them in meetings behind the scenes. So anyways, our movement is definitely on it.
We're very glad to hear that. That sounds fantastic. As a related question from Sergei, so many NGOs, civil societies, organizations, and the voices of the community are promoting and implementing the Sustainable Development Goals. By focusing on Sustainable Development Goal 5, 10, and 13, what actions could NGOs propose? So environment, gender, development, to governments, funding bodies, to better incorporate women's empowerment and gender equity into programs, policies, and financing of climate change? That's a really hard question, but I think it's a really important one in terms of not putting in things into silos. So gender equality is not a separate thing from fighting climate change in environmental movements. We have to do these things together. And I think too often in the past, even the work with men on gender equality has been separate from the work of women on gender equality. So how do we bring these things together? And can we use the Sustainable Development Goals as a kind of way of carrying them forward? Does anybody want to come in on that?
I can say something. I mean, this is the reason why we are doing this seminar series within Men Engage. We are starting to look at how can we, as a network focusing on gender equality, start to also include the environment and the climate, step out of that silo and into looking at how these things are interlinked and have the same root causes. I had something more I wanted to say. Oh, I lost it. I come back.
Okay. It happens to all of us.
Maybe, yeah, thank you. Maybe I can suggest, using universal periodic report of the states, using CEDA reports, I think putting in there issues of like combining in NGO reports, putting all these issues together, reflecting on how they are connected, and make actually members of the CEDA committee, UN Women, and other UN agencies to start thinking, connecting these dots, because that's what we see when we speak about the Global Treaty on Violence Against Women and Girls. I can tell you that many countries, most of governments at the moment, they think separately about these issues. And when we started talking about that together, it was very interesting that it inspires actually more response on both issues. So I think using the instruments that NGOs have, like universal periodic report that states have to provide once in like 5 years, CEDA committee one in 4 years. I think just, combining these issues in those reports probably will start changing how it is viewed.
Thank you, Marina. Marcelo, you said I agree. Do you want to say anything else?
I agree with the Kathleen,
with Katrine's point.
She says, when she says the COVID crisis is a general reversal for climate crisis, and building health connections, take care in an inclusive way, will be the key to solve both climate crises. I do agree with this.
Yeah, absolutely. I think we would all agree with that. That's a really good point, Katrine. Okay, so Paul's saying, in our third book on ecological masculinities, we're planning a documentary to accompany the book that interviews folks like you, all of you all, about your respective thoughts and feelings about your inner and outer experiences with the masculine. Can we contact you as possible interviewees to assist with the project? Paul, do you want to put your email in the chat box? And then if anybody's interested in that, they can email you, because otherwise I think we may get confused between emails to Vidar and emails to you. Okay, great. Thank you very much.
Nikki, I wanted to introduce Maxim Rusanov here from Russia, and he does very interesting work. Maybe we can listen for like 3 minutes. Maxim, if you don't mind, telling what men say in your group
Is it possible to unmute Maxime? I know it's... You can't unmute yourself, Maxime. I think we have to unmute you. So yeah, I'm just asking. Go for it. Yeah.
Just give me a second.
Thank you.
And everybody needs to listen to English translation because Maxime will be speaking in Russian.
Yeah. Yeah. So if you want to listen to English, go down to that little thing, little bottom of your screen. There's something that says English and Russian.
Привет всем. Привет. Я хочу сказать, что в группах, мужских группах, которые обсуждают проблему экологии и ненасилия по отношению к женщин, к женщинам, точкой входа для многих является эмпатия к самим себе. Высокий уровень насильственных причин смерти у мужчин, по крайней мере, в России. Большой уровень самоубийств иногда не связывается с этой жестокостью. Но когда говоришь мужчинам об эмпатии к себе, к женщинам и к природе, тогда все это нанизывается на одну, все эти бусины нанизываются на одну нить. И многим мужчинам становится понятно, что они жестоки к себе, к женщинам и, конечно, к природе. И тогда они готовы об этом говорить. Вот такой опыт. Спасибо.
That's really interesting. Thank you very much, Maxime. And it reinforces what Marina was saying in your project as well. We think about violence. I'm just remembering a quote about ending violence, also about caring. So there's clearly a link. They're the kind of different sides of the same coin. I think we're kind of sadly coming to the end of this discussion. So I want to just thank all of you for really, I've learned such a lot, been fantastic and very different kinds of perspectives. I was just trying to think about what I'd picked up and so many things, but just a couple of things. Anuna's point about this affects us all, but those with privilege have the main responsibility to change things, felt to me to be really important. And then the point about, you know, people with privilege being able to sit with uncomfortableness is also really key. I think, Vida, you had a quote about feel part of something makes it harder to dominate and easier to care. Something else I remember, along with your kind of a piece about, you know, embodiment as well. And then Marina, you talking about the ways that things change, and what Maxime's been talking about, the links between the ecological movement and the feminist and gender equality movements. And, you know, they're not separate. And if we're thinking about violence towards the environment and our planet, we also think about violence on an individual level. So it's back again to thinking about the links between the individual and the structural that are really, really important. And then finally, I guess I keep coming back to Marcelo's lovely, lovely phrase around radical dreams. And we need to be radical dreamers and radical listeners, especially to Indigenous people. I would also add, especially to young people in this context, because actually I think young people are clearly leading the way. And it's been so lovely to have all your voices on this. So thank you very, very much. There'll be more climate change sessions and masculinities in the Ubuntu symposium. And I think, Bianca, you want to tell us a little bit about other Ubuntu symposium sessions before we sign off. So over to you.
Thanks, Mickey. So just to share, I'll just share my screen quickly just to share with you what's coming up next week. We are back into regular scheduling. So we're on Tuesday. Tuesday, we have the fifth in our discussion paper series around systems change and masculinities. And so we're skipping that one. We're having all about movement. There's a conversation with the author of this book, Srilata Bathilwa. It'll be in English, Spanish, and French. So we do invite you to join us. Srilata is a very inspiring and moving speaker, and we think that we'll all learn a lot about this from her. On Wednesday, we have the Organizing Native Men and Youth in Native Communities. It's a two-part series put on by NAMEN, the North American Men Engaged Network. So the first part is on Wednesday at 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And then the second is on Thursday, also at 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Also on Thursday in the morning, Eastern Standard Time, we have The Killing of Youth and Masculinities. We have Boundless Love, Reimagining Relationships for a Degendered World. Then Networking and Advocacy for the Integration of the African Great Lakes Region's Agenda into Beijing Plus 25 and the Generation Equality Global Forum. And that will be in French and English. So there's a lot coming up. We are having programs every Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, now all the way through until the 22nd of June. So we do invite you to join us. And just thank you again to everyone for being on the session, to all the speakers, to the organizers, and to all the participants. And we'll see you again soon. Thank you.
Go
ahead, Vida.
Thank you. Bye. Yeah,
sorry, just before you leave, if you haven't already, please, we have some minute left. Write something in the chat, what you bring with you from this session, as a way of,
Thank you, Vida. That'd be lovely. I was just going to say, and also, so Robin's also made the point about conclusions from a study on male reflective groups, because it's especially important for men to practice emotional relational abilities. So yeah, do write things in the chat. Do go if you need to go. And I also want to thank Irina for a wonderful translation. Much appreciated. I don't think translators get thanked enough. And also to the Men Engaged team for getting up really early, and for the rest of you who've had to get up really early for this session. Thank you very much and goodbye.
Thank you, Nikki, for moderating it. And thank you, everybody.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, everybody. I would like to say one thing that I learned from Anuna and the people here in the Amazon rainforest. It's, what do we want? Climate justice. And when do we want it? Now. Everybody can repeat it with us.
I don't think you can unmute yourself. Yeah.
We can do it though. Go on then. What do we want?
Climate justice.
When do we want it?
Now.
Yay. Thank you, Marcella.